everyone, and welcome to the Culture Cast. I'm Chris Stashew, and I am joined by the man who put the Mike White in Mike White March, the projection booth's own, Mr. Mike White.
I put the bump in the bump to bump bump to bump.
I thought you were going to say you put the special in the special inspector.
Ooh.
Oh, dear God. This movie is a special film for everyone to enjoy together. So on this episode of the Culture Cast, we're actually continuing Mike White March with a look at The Dragonflies, otherwise known as the title I watched it under, the title you watched it under, The Man from Hong Kong.
Nobody is safe from the man from Hong Kong.
Listen, there's a Chinese cop in town. He's beginning to annoy me. Yeah, I think he should meet with a slight accident.
Jimmy Wang Yu is the man from Hong Kong. A furious arsenal of martial arts. With his sights set on smashing organized crime.
In my country, Caroline, we have a sport. We take the giant praying mantis, put him in the wooden cage, and make him fight for his life with his own kind. I thought you would enjoy such a sport.
You and Jack Wilton in a wooden cage. He's a very dangerous man.
George Lazenby is Jack Wilton. Gunrunner, dope peddler, ruthless czar of international evil.
I've never met a Chinese yet that didn't have a yellow streak.
East meets West in a head-on clash with no holds barred. Golden Harvest, who made Bruce Lee a box office smash, have joined with Australia's action specialists to produce a death-defying spectacle that staggers the senses. The Man from Hong Kong knows no rules. Everyone he runs across is never quite the same again.
I understand the gunman is dead.
How did that happen?
I killed him.
Really?
Well, in that case, you deserve a cigar.
Thank you. I don't smoke.
Tell me, Inspector, do you often take white girls to bed?
Only on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
This is nice.
What did you expect? Acupuncture?
So do yourself a favor and answer a few questions.
省点劲儿吧，被他妈来陪我，我也不会告诉你。
Yeah, and I love you too. Yes!
This is Australia, mate, not 55 days at Peking.
Hey, don't give me any shit.
Provoke him at your peril.
I want that lunatic stopped.
Nothing stands in his way. For long, nobody's safe from the man from Hong Kong.
The Man from Hong Kong was directed by Brian Trenchard-Smith and Jimmy Wang Yu. It's written by Brian Trenchard-Smith, stars Jimmy Wang Yu, George Lazenby, yes, that George Lazenby, and once again, Hugh Keyes Bairn. Film centers around Jimmy Wang Yu as the eponymous man from Hong Kong who goes to Australia to extradite a drug dealer played by everyone's favorite fat kung fu artist, Sammo Hung, and he gets killed, and so the man from Hong Kong has to take down the drug lord in Australia, in Sydney specifically. So I'm curious, because obviously, Mike, you programmed this month with the help of your friend who is Australian. I'm curious, did he tell you why, or do you have a reason as to why we watched The Man from Hong Kong?
I imagine that it is one of the larger in the Ozploitation things, judging by Mark Hartley's, not quite Hollywood documentary. It was definitely featured in that. And Brian Trenchard-Smith made a lot of interesting films, and this was a nice crossover with the Hong Kong market. I read rumors that perhaps Bruce Lee was supposed to star in this at one point. There was a lot of friction on set between Trenchard-Smith and Jimmy Wang Yu. But yeah, this kind of brought the martial arts into Ozploitation, which was kind of a cool thing. I don't know if there were others before this, but this one definitely has left a mark. And yeah, it's got a lot of very familiar faces. You mentioned Hughes Keys Byrne, and then there was Roger Ward as his partner, who we just saw last week as well, also in Stone. And yeah, and George Lazenby, not quite fresh off of his turn as James Bond, but playing a really good dastardly villain and doing some awesome kung fu moves.
Yeah, this movie is a lot of fun. It's also like way too long. way too long. It is about a half an hour too long, and it feels it. This is a film that feels too long, for sure. It's almost 2 hours, man. Like, whew.
Yeah, after a while, I was like, okay, I really don't need to see any more kung fu.
Or Jimmy Wang Yu fucking white women.
Jimmy Wang Yu with just that incredible dubbed, lacking emotion voice. Just, yes, I am here now. This is great.
Yeah, he's, oh, Jesus. Jackie Chan, he is not.
No.
Let's just say that much. He lacks the charisma necessary to carry a film like this, which is fine because it's not a film that I would say a lot of Western audiences have seen. However, when tasked with carrying a film, it falls so very short.
Yeah, he needs a charisma injection.
Yeah, and I don't know if that's because it was dubbed in post, or if he just doesn't have any, or if it was the script saying, hey, kind of be a hard-ass cop. But everyone else in the film is having a good time. George Lazenby is rocking that fucking mustache and having a fun time with the movie. I mean, George Lazenby, most people know him as James Bond. But he's the James Bond that often gets, I don't know, not overlooked, but
he's
overlooked.
The asterisk. You know, he's got the one movie, which I still contend is one of the better Bond films. And it did a lot of things that, like, the Daniel Craig Bond would end up doing, where it's kind of down and the woman dies and this kind of stuff. There's also a little bit of winking at the camera, the whole this never happened to the other fellow, that one and stuff. But I really enjoy that film. And I don't know if it was just like, oh my God, he's Australian, get him out of here, or what happened behind the scenes why he got kicked off of that. But it was kind of a famous departure for him. And he's gone on to be in a lot of good things. He was in a movie that I really like called St. Jack, usually smaller parts. I think he was also in, oh God, what is that movie with Gene Simmons, Never Too Young to Die. He's in that and basically playing James Bond again in that film.
So we talked, I want to say, I mean, you and I have been friends for a while now, and we've been doing podcasts together for a while. So I want to say you and I did On Her Majesty's Secret Service together.
It could
Does
that
be. Sound right? Because
maybe.
I know you like that movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I asked you, I was like, do any of these strike your fancy? And you were like, well, I love this one. So, and that's a rare thing because, like you said, that is not the one that leaps to the forefront when people are like, do you like this James Bond? What's your favorite? And not very many people are like, George Lazenby is my favorite. Which is fine because, like you said, that movie's actually pretty good and it has a really weird ending. Like, for a James Bond movie, it's definitely not what I would expect. But again, it's carried by his performance because he's great in that movie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's fantastic. And I'm not just being contrarian when I go, well, I'll pick the one that nobody else picks. I'll pick on Her Majesty's Secret Service.
No, that would be, I love Quantum of Solace.
Oh, God.
Which I will contend is a better movie if you watch it and the first movie back to back. It's not as bad, because I know you were on that podcast with me.
Oh, yeah.
It's and not
I just
as
despise
bad.
Despise that movie.
It's not as bad if you watch it as one whole film, but it's still pretty bad.
Yeah.
But back to George Lazenby, he is the reason this film is as much fun to watch as it is. Because he is fantastic in this movie.
He's a lot of fun. And yeah, you mentioned Sammo, and it was such a surprise. I didn't know Sammo was in this movie. And during that opening, I was like, is that Sammo? There's no way that can be Sammo. And it took me a little while before I was like, okay, for sure. And then when they had the confrontation in the prison cell, it was funny because he was doing a lot of his shtick with the whole, like, I missed the guy, now I'm going to shake my hand because it really hurt. And I was like, that doesn't really fit with this film, because this film is much more badass and he's kind of more comic, but it was still so great to see him. And then I was super happy because even though he's the man from Hong Kong, for whatever reason, they're both speaking Mandarin. So I was really happy because I could actually understand some of the things that they were saying. So when he's like, Ta Shi, I was like, oh, he's asking, who is he? And I didn't even do subtitles.
Yeah, I really was surprised because, like you said, Sammo is not, this is not a Sammo Hung film stylistically. But it was kind of cool to see him in it. I mean, he's very young. Like
super young. That bowl cut kind of grown out a little bit. I was like, that's kind of nasty.
I mean, he's a flunky. He's a flunky in this movie. He's not given much to do. At the beginning of the film, they fight on Ayers Rock. It's totally Ayers Rock, I think.
Oh, it totally is. They even mention it right at the beginning. Yeah.
Let me put it this way. When I went to Ayers Rock, you weren't allowed to climb it anymore. So the 70s were a wilder time. Because if you were climbing Ayers Rock the way they climbed it, you'd break your fucking neck.
Yeah, I just was listening to a book about the Mad Max series, and they were saying that after some people shot at Ayers Rock, there was a lot of some bad stuff that happened at there as well as some other landmarks. So the Aboriginal people, surprisingly, they had enough power to put a stop to that. So when George Miller wanted to shoot some things for Thunderdome on Aboriginal land, he had to go and like make a pitch to the Aboriginal Council in order to get permission. But I think it was movies like this and a few others that kind of fucked up the situation because maybe they weren't as respectful as they should have been.
Yeah, I mean, that is like it's like a spiritual place. And you got Sammo Hung's fat ass flying around on it, fighting a cop. Like, yeah, not exactly the best way. And also, some bad things happen. Maybe like a woman going out there with her baby and it getting eaten by a dingo. I don't know. That may or may not have something to do with it as well. But it's nice that it's filmed on location, which is fun. You never get that wide shot. I was hoping for that wide shot of like you see Ayers Rock and then you see them fighting on the side of it.
Yeah.
Which feels like a really missed opportunity if you're going to film on something as iconic as Ayers Rock, the largest rock in the world, and you never have like a wide shot of them on it. It's just like these very close-up shots, which could have been filmed like, you know, anywhere as far as I'm concerned. Like, you know,
I only remember the shots in front of it, especially that car exploding and the way that the door flies right next to the camera.
Right. Well, then they climb up it. I mean,
I don't even remember that. That's funny.
Sammo and the other cop, I believe. Oh, is it Roger Ward who plays the other cop? Yeah. He plays the other cop. Like, he fights with him up on the thing.
Okay.
And but it's like, again, like, it's not particularly memorable because they could be fighting anywhere. Like, there's like a helicopter in the air at one point. You could have seen like a helicopter shot of them fighting or anything. But no, it's just kind of like a very close-up shot. Not anything particularly cool or exciting or memorable from like a visual standpoint. But Sammo is in this movie, which I was surprised by because
it wasn't as memorable as that whole chase with Grant Page that goes on forever, but in a good way.
That goes on a little too long. It's one of the parts of the movie that I feel like went on way too long.
Yeah. I liked it. And I liked when Jimmy Wang Yu kicked him off the motorcycle.
I'm not saying it was bad. It's just the issue for me is that this film is a little too long, and there are parts that are clear to me need to be cut down. The chase needs to be cut down. Frankly, if you're asking me, the parts that need to be cut down are anything where he goes to that farm in the nowhere.
Yeah, yeah.
With Rebecca Gilling playing like another woman who is enamored with Jimmy Wang Yu's Asian-ness, as I would put it in the least offensive way. She holds her fingers on her eyes and does the stereotypical Asian thing at one point. I was like, whoa now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she definitely likes Jimmy's Wang.
You?
Of course I do, too.
Yeah, it was I didn't know what to make of that.
Yeah, that was a little racially insensitive, but then I can only say, like, oh, it was the mid-70s.
Right, I'm not offended at all. Like,
no.
Yeah, it's a movie called The Man from Hong Kong, otherwise known as The Dragon Flies, where in the first 15 minutes of the movie, a woman is like, oh, show me why you're the special inspector. It's like, what the fuck? And then they're just fucking in his bed. Yeah. I'm surprised she didn't say, oh, show me the secrets of the Orient. Like, Jesus, it was one line away from
ancient Chinese secret, huh?
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, it was one line away from being that kind of not racist, but like kind of off color.
Yeah. Yeah.
But again, like, it's a movie from the 70s. It's an Ozploitation film. If you're expecting to watch these films and not kind of be like, what the fuck were they thinking? Then you shouldn't watch exploitation films.
Right. Right. Exactly. And yeah, it wasn't going to be super highbrow kind of stuff.
No. Which is fine, because I think at one point George Lazenby also says, like, oh, you're the same. You'll have a yellow streak in you. I was like, oh, boy.
Wah, nice. Wah.
Oh, yeah. Wah, wah was right. But it's a fun movie. It's kind of it kind of has, and I'm curious if you picked up on this, it kind of has like a James Bond thing to it.
Oh, yeah. It totally does.
Like,
yes.
Not Asian James Bond, because that's not the case. Like, Australian James Bond.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that.
Which was the nickname for George Lazenby because he is Australian. So maybe not the Australian James Bond, maybe the Australian James Bond by way of Hong Kong.
Right. In those scenes, like the use of the hang glider, which they kept calling the kite for whatever reason, the hang glider and stuff. I was like, okay, I think I've actually seen this in James Bond movies. I don't know if it was before or after that they used the hang glider, but it reminded me of, like, you know, Roger Moore skiing at the beginning of one of those films. I was like, okay, yeah, it doesn't necessarily have the, I guess it does kind of have that cold open kind of thing, but it's not necessarily Jimmy Wang Yu doing all of the action stuff. It's the other cops. And then he's introduced to the story. But yeah, I definitely got very much a, let's say, James Bond by way of Hong Kong and Australia.
I don't remember. All the James Bond movies, are all the cold opens, do they all have James Bond?
You know, I don't remember either, but I thought that they did.
Right? Like, I think so, but again, like, I wouldn't be surprised if they had ever made a James Bond movie that took place in Australia. That, like, this would have been the setting a little bit. Like, fighting on Ayers Rock. Like, stuff like that.
Oh, yeah. They would have been climbing up the Sydney Opera House at the end, though.
Yeah, or running along the Bay Bridge.
Right.
You know, something like that where it's, like, over the top, but they always have to integrate, like, the landmarks, like, in View to a Kill, where Christopher Walken falls off the Golden Gate Bridge, which, by the way, is still a guilty pleasure James Bond movie of mine, regardless of what anyone says.
I guess what you're saying is, like, North by Northwest is kind of the bro Bond.
Like, kind of, right?
Yeah. I mean, because really, when you watch that end at Mount Rushmore, it feels very James Bondish in retrospect.
And, like, this one kind of has it. I mean, I don't know if that building that they were in was some landmark. I'm assuming it's not. It looked just like a normal building. Mm-hmm. But it's still part of the Sydney skyline.
Right.
And but like that ending is the ending of this film is so much fun. And it's like so it's so kind of over the top, but also very contained in a way that I really appreciated, where you've got like it's essentially like a fight in one room, but there's a lot of moving parts.
Yeah, it's very video game-esque, like I'm going to go up the elevator and then fight the thug in the elevator, who, by the way, is Brian Trenchard-Smith, and apparently Jimmy Wang Yu did not take it to him, really gave him what for, like some of those reaction shots where he's kind of in extreme pain, those were not necessarily acting.
Oh, you mean on top of the building?
No, on top of the elevator when he's going up, there's a guy that fights him in the elevator shaft. That was the director.
Fights him in the elevator shaft.
Yeah, he's in an elevator and the elevator stops. Jimmy's in the elevator and it stops and he gets out.
Oh, right.
There's a thug there.
Right.
And there's a big fight on top of that elevator before he gets up to Lazenby's level and then has that fight where Lazenby gets set on fire.
Which is, they set him on fire.
Oh, yeah.
They set George Lazenby on fire.
Which is hilarious because just a few weeks ago, I was talking about that Overlord or whatever, that movie from Bad Robot. And I was like, the fire in that movie looks so fake. And then I watched this where they're really setting people on fire. And I was like, this is what I'm talking about.
My feelings are kind of hurt because that wasn't me.
Really? I thought that we talked about
that. I haven't seen Overlord yet.
Oh, it's okay. It's like a video game movie, even though it's not based on a video game.
And thankfully, it's also not part of the Cloverfield universe.
I'm sure I could spin up a fan theory for you if you wanted.
But at least it doesn't have the name Clover.
No, thank God.
Yeah. Because if it was named Clover Lord, I would be... I mean, 10 Cloverfield Lane, Cloverfield Paradox. It was initially a Cloverfield film and it wasn't. So,
it would make sense because you could have a disembodied arm crawling and writing in this movie much more sensical than you could in the Cloverfield Paradox.
Oof, Jesus Christ.
Right?
Cloverfield Paradox was real bad.
Very bad. When they made their worst of 2018 lists, they tend to forget that one.
Well, according to Steven Spielberg, it doesn't really count.
Oh, that's right, because it's a Netflix film. That's right.
Right, but Steven Spielberg's Ready Player One should have been on every worst of list because that movie was a piece of shit.
Right at the top, baby.
Yeah, right at the number one with the bullet. Our bullet. Because that movie is garbage. And it's also a bad book as well. But, you know, don't take my word for it. Go listen to all the people on the internet who think that dropping 10 references about how you totally get nerd culture on every page of your book is super cool. I digress. But the fire scene, I'm like, I'm still in shock.
Right.
For how long he was on fire. And I know it was slowed down. I know it was filmed in slow motion, but like, every time I watch Nightmare on Elm Street, when I see how long Freddy is on fire walking up the staircase and knowing that that's almost like a minute of the stuntman in the suit being on fire, I'm impressed. And then when I look at George Lazenby, who's not a stuntman, being lit on fire, and you can like see he's visibly like not in pain, but like
he
terrified.
Gets panicked.
He's panicked. Yeah. It's like, holy shit, how did you get him to agree to do this?
You know how? Is because Brian Trenchard-Smith set himself on fire first and said, see, it can be done.
Yeah, that's not a good way to convince me to do something. It'd be like someone saying, hey, look, they chop their pinky off. They're like, I can live without a pinky and so can you. It's like, is it really living though?
Well, in that kind of machismo culture of Australia at the time, I think it would have been like, well, you either set yourself on fire like the director or you're pufta.
Well, I was hoping you'd do some sort of Australian accent with that to really convey the gruff sensibility of the country from which they live, where they've got more like animals that can kill you per capita than any country in the world. God, yeah, that the fact that that's the way he convinced him to do it is just butt fucking insane. Like, I haven't watched that documentary yet, and I probably should have before we watched this, but I haven't gotten around to it yet. But that is fucking nuts.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I'll light myself on fire, and then you'll do it. Not, no. No, that line of reasoning is severely flawed.
I have to say, I really like Hugh Keysburn and Roger Ward as the police officers. Like, they could have been so annoying. They could have totally been... like the, you know, and they try to do that. They're like, oh, we're going to drive you to the airport tomorrow. You got to go back home. They're like, you know, the two cops from Beverly Hills Cop where it's like, okay, Axel, we're going to drive you back and put you on the airplane. Your inspector says we got to send you back. And they're kind of those characters, but they're just so fucking crazy. Like Hugh Keysburn, that hair, it's just so wild. And just him like always having to say that he is undercover narcotics and stuff, and that's how he gets away with looking like this complete bum like he does. And I love that stupid shot when he like kicks and he kicks towards the camera and blocks out the camera for a second. It's so cheesy, but I love it.
I wish there was more of him in this movie.
I do too.
Because the amount of personality that Jimmy Wang Yu doesn't have stinks up the film. When you've got all these like other players who are so more like, vibrant and well-defined as characters.
Yeah.
And then you have him who's just like, I like to fuck white women. I'm looking for Wilton. Okay.
Yeah.
Great. Your character has a lot of motivation. Like, that is my biggest complaint with this movie, is his character is so goddamn flat.
It is pretty flat, but I can kind of forgive it. Like you said, it's a little much, like, the end of the second act into the beginning of the third act could really be trimmed down a lot. It does drag there for a little bit, but otherwise, I'm okay with stuff.
The scene in the martial arts studio at night,
yeah,
is a little much.
Yeah, I was totally reminded of Black Belt Jones for whatever reason. I guess because of the, you know, surprise, motherfucker.
Yeah, that whole scene is just, it goes on for way too long.
Yeah.
Like all these kung fu guys, just like martial arts guys just show up out of nowhere. Like, here we are. Like, what? Oof. Okay.
Including apparently Lam Ching Ying and Yuen Biao are in this movie as uncredited guys.
I mean, that's not surprising, is it?
No, definitely not. I mean, they were friends with Sammo.
Right. I would have been more surprised if Jackie Chan had been in the movie.
Right.
Right. Because that would have been cool. I mean, it wouldn't have done anything, but.
I mean, you were talking about the scene when he's on fire, and I was totally thinking of The Legend of the Drunken Master when he's on fire in that and going across those hot coals.
Yeah. This, I think, is more impressive.
I won't disagree. But
only
because
it's George Lazenby.
Right. Exactly. He hasn't been doing stunts like these all of his life.
Yeah. I mean, it's so weird to me that George Lazenby is in this movie as a villain, considering how he's kind of just James Bond.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, when you're James Bond, you're kind of always James Bond. Like, Connery, Dalton, like, they've kind of always been trying to push back against that typecasting.
Yeah, but I think he succeeded the most. Because
I would agree.
When you see something like St. Jack, where I think he plays a gay CIA person, I mean, you would see him and stuff, and you'd be like, wow, I never pictured that he could do that. No, he's a senator. That's right.
Yeah, he's good in this movie. I've never seen that movie. It's
pretty good. It's Peter Bogdanovich at the top of his game.
But I like George Lazenby, so.
Yeah.
I mean, he's good. He's, you know, again, like, he's given more to do than Jimmy Wang Yu.
Yeah. And you're going to see, you know, we talked a little bit last week about Bill Hunter, who was the bartender in Stone. He showed up in this movie as a guy named Peterson. There's a guy named Willard, played by Frank Thring, I believe is how you pronounce his last name. He's going to be the big baddie next week in Mad Dog Morgan. I think Bill Hunter comes back as well. And Grant Page does stunts in Mad Dog Morgan, too, including setting himself on fire and falling backwards down this huge cliff into water.
Good Lord. Like, these Australian dudes, like, they're fucking hardcore.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Like, real hardcore.
If memory serves, I want to say, I know for sure that Hugh Keyes Byrne shows up in Mad Dog Morgan when we talk about that. And I want to say Roger Ward even shows up. It's that thing that we were talking about last week where it's this small gene pool of people who are working at this point.
Well, and again, that's what makes Ozploitation so fun, is that you do get to see these people kind of coming back and doing different things. Because, you know, Hugh Keyes Byrne last week was a, you know, renegade biker, and this week he's a cop.
Right.
So it's a lot of fun. I mean, it's a lot of fun to kind of see where their career is going with these different roles all in the same kind of circle. Hopefully no more Jimmy Wang Yu.
I don't think so. I think we're okay with that.
Like, in regards to this, like, because we just did Jackie Chan movies a couple months back, it really goes to show how much of a drag your kung fu movie is if you don't have a charismatic lead.
Right. Even the lesser Jackie films that we watched, he is so much better than Jimmy is in this movie.
Yeah. Jimmy Wang Yu is, like, I can't stress enough how much of a drag he is on this film.
I mean, I am curious to see him in other stuff, because not only was he an actor, but he also was a director. And there's a little bit of contention about his direction credit on here. Apparently he just wanted to take over a lot of stuff. But I want to go back. There's a lot of the movies that he directed available on Amazon Prime right now. So I want to go back and see those, though they're probably like full screen and looking nasty. But if I've seen The One-Armed Boxer, it's been a long time. And I've seen The Master of the Flying Guillotine. Again, it's been a long time. Go back and see those and see how he works out with those things.
So what you're saying is Jimmy Wang Yu is the kind of guy who likes to not only star in his own film, but also direct it.
Correct. And maybe even write occasionally.
Oh, boy. So he's one of those types.
Oh, yeah. He is a hyphenate.
Hmm. He's an asshole. That's what it sounds like. I mean, it's, you know.
We just talked about Jackie Chan. He does all those things.
Yeah, but Jackie Chan's not a turd.
Yeah. Well, maybe this was enough. I don't know.
Well, again, he didn't endear me to his performance did not endear himself to me in this film.
No.
That is my big takeaway, is that, I mean, can you imagine how cool this movie had been if it had had Jackie Chan or Bruce Lee in it?
I can't even begin to imagine.
Right. Because it fits right in there with the other kind of Jackie Chan, like this film almost feels like made for Jackie Chan. Right.
Yeah. I mean, I guess this would have to be Jackie when he's like Inspector Jackie kind of a role.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, the humor's not there with Jimmy Wang Yu. I don't know if the humor would fit if Jackie brought that in. But, we've seen Jackie do serious as well.
Yeah. And that's the other thing is, like, I assume it would have more humor. I mean, that last fight scene has a lot of humor in it. Like,
true.
When he ties the grenade in Lazenby's mouth.
That was awesome.
Right? I mean, that whole end scene is great. But, like, I wonder what it would have been like with a more charismatic actor in the lead role.
Yeah, true.
So, Mike, what would you give The Dragonflies, a.k.a. The Man from Hong Kong?
I would give this a very solid 3, if not 3.5.
Yeah, I would give it a 3. I mean, Lazenby and Hugh Keysburn are really what pushes it. Lazenby is amazing.
Yeah.
He knows how to ham it up as a bad guy. But yeah, Jimmy Wang Yu, just, boy, all the good things about this movie just go down the drain when you talk about Jimmy Wang Yu on screen.
I mean, I would probably watch this again sometime, but I'm not going to rush out to see it a second time
anytime soon.
There's a lot of other, even Brian Trenchard-Smith films that I want to see before I go and watch this one again. I want to see BMX Bandits. I want to see Stunt Rock. I want to see Dead End Drive-In. So I'll keep checking out his films and then maybe eventually circle back to this one.
And maybe, hopefully, those films have more charismatic leads in them.
We can.
Because if we have a film where an hour and a half of it is an actor who doesn't seem like he wants to be there and he's 80-yard into the ground, maybe not the best film.
Yeah.
So let's take a break and we'll play a preview for the next Culture Cast.
You.
In the autumn of 1865, notorious bushranger Daniel Morgan crossed from New South Wales into Victoria to do battle with the law for the last time. What happened has been a secret for over 100 years. Now the fascinating truth can be told.
Stan! Or he'll blow your bloody head off and I'll knock out all your teeth.
I want the cry of my hounds in his ears. I want his spleen on my desk by sundown.
The truth about Mad Dog Morgan is now an epic movie, recreating the turbulent gold fields, the sprawling sheep stations, and the festering prisons of early Australia.
You wouldn't be so game if I wasn't tied down like a dog.
Dennis Hopper.
Stand up, Bogey, move forward.
In the finest performance of his career, brilliantly recreates the enigma that was Morgan. A giant of a man trapped by the nightmare of his own legend.
The way he looked at me, Lord, addressing me with his eyes. God, nightmares for the rest of my life. God. Thought of him kissing me, touching me. Horrible, disgusting.
I've missed so much of my life, sir. And I'm not trying to be sentimental either. Do you know how lucky I am to be Dan Morgan, sir?
Mad Dog Morgan brings you all the passion, the spectacle, the savage beauty of the tumultuous Gold Rush era, vividly portrayed by an outstanding cast.
Ha-ha! Boomerang!
What next? A corroboree?
You could have been shot.
Shot be damned. I'm the magistrate of Wagga Wagga.
The police across the river border are totally and completely incompetent. We will not tolerate anarchy in our colony.
Everyone is talking about it. You won last 24 hours in Victoria.
A senior officer here. I assume command of this situation.
I'll get the bastard.
He's a name with £1,000 reward and blood on his hands.
This is Morgan Country, where it happened. And this is Morgan. Ferociously violent. Unexpectedly kind.
My wagon?
I'll be giving you a pound. And only for one reason. That I may have to take it back from you someday.
Mad Dog Morgan.
He's got giant balls, that one.
Symbol of terror to the wealthy and the powerful.
Burn it down, Billy! Burn it down! Burn it down!
Was he a monster or a martyr? A ruthless bandit or a rebel hero? Outwitting, outriding, outgunning an army of police. Here at last is the truth about Mad Dog Morgan, the outlaw's outlaw.
That's right. On the next CultureCast, we're going to be talking about a film that we mentioned a couple times, Mad Dog Morgan. It stars Dennis Hopper. Until then, where can people find you, Mike?
You can find me with Chris Dashew over at the Kolchak Tapes, which is at kolchaktapes.com. You can also find us over at the Twilight Zone 85 podcast, which is available at Twilight Zone 85. The name of that is Dreams for Sale. And you can always find me over at Projection Booth, which is available at theprojectionboothpodcast.com.
And you can find me on Twitter at CultureStash. You can find the podcast on Twitter at CultureCast and at CultureCast.com, where you'll find links to Patreon, the rest of the episodes, and all kinds of exciting stuff. So head on over there. Big thanks as always to you, Mike, for programming this month and joining me on every podcast.
Well, thanks to you, and thanks to Morris Brzezinski for helping us out here with this programming.
Yeah, big thank you, because it gives us a little bit of credibility to have someone who actually probably grew up watching these films saying, like, yeah, we should probably do this and this and not this one.